risen Christ. Amen. So I listened to this podcast by the author Malcolm Gladwell. Maybe you've seen or heard of him and maybe read some of his books, David and Goliath or Outliers or one of those ones. And he has this podcast called Revisionist History, in which he discusses things that may have been forgotten or misunderstood and how that affects our telling of history or certain incidents throughout history. As he says, because sometimes the past deserves a second chance. So in an episode from last season, he takes on the song Hallelujah in a discussion about how genius emerges. Maybe you have heard this song, Hallelujah, in a TV show or a movie, because it's in about every single one of them. And or maybe it's one of your favorite songs, and you've heard every version that's ever been made. Maybe you've never heard it at all, then you're going to be in for a treat, because I'm going to play a few of them this morning. But the version that a lot of people have heard is the version by Jeff Buckley. But the original is from Leonard Cohen. And if you know Leonard Cohen, you know his sound. And so this Hallelujah song started with Leonard Cohen and started in kind of an interesting place. And so I'm going to play you the Leonard Cohen version, not the whole thing, just a little bit of it here. And we'll kind of progress through with how this song took place. So you recognize that song? Maybe not the Leonard Cohen. It's not great. The Leonard Cohen version is not great. And there's many versions of the song that have been recorded since then. But I imagine if I'd have heard that song first, I likely would not have gone back to it. It's not a great version of the song, but that is where it started. And you really have to like Leonard Cohen, or you have to like the song and appreciate its roots to really like that version of the song. But what happened is that it was heard by this guy named John Cale. And he heard Cohen's version, and he put his own spin on it and put that original piano riff at the beginning, or that kind of piano riff that we recognize. At the beginning of it, and it became a new song, and I think probably a better song, and it goes like this.
I learned there was a secret chord that David played and pleased the Lord, but you don't really care for music. Goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Same song, but a new song. He added that familiar piano thing at the beginning and added some emotion to the song, some actual singing at the beginning. But it became a new song. But the thing that Malcolm Gladwell talks about in the podcast is even this song was largely obscure. That it was put on an album and ignored, and just by chance, just by pure chance, Jeff Buckley was house sitting at a house and put on this random John Cale album that had this song, Hallelujah, and Jeff Buckley heard it. He rearranged it, made it his own, and went out to a club and played it at a club and was heard by a music executive and got an album deal and made his only album. And this Hallelujah, Jeff Buckley's version of Hallelujah, was on that album just by chance. And so here's the version that I would imagine a lot of you have heard, if you've heard it. Even better version yet, if you're asking my opinion, and probably very emotional. If you like that song, that is the one that really tugs at the heartstrings. And that's why that song has been remade millions and, or not millions, many, many times over, and has been on every TV show or movie that has a sad kind of scene in it, because that. Because the progression has made it that much more emotional and that much more sad. But the interesting thing is that that particular version by Jeff Buckley also remained very obscure until a freak accident in which he died at a very young age, and his album became this kind of speaking from the grave. And amazingly, that song Hallelujah became this kind of tribute to Jeff Buckley and the short life that he had. And that's when it blew up in movies and in popularity, and you probably heard it on Shrek and in all sorts of different movies that that have come along, and people have remade this song over and over. And but the point is, all of that is to say, is that Hallelujah, the original version by Leonard Cohen, needed to become a new song a couple different times, along with some pretty serendipitous and unfortunate events along the way to make it happen. But it needed to become, it needed to go through all of these new versions of itself to be what it is today, a new song, remade by quite a few people, but beloved by so many that hear it. And so I talk about new songs because the people to whom John wrote this letter of Revelation, those seven churches of his time period, were in need of a new song. Those seven churches that John writes to, as I mentioned last week, are struggling with life under this oppressive rule of this Roman Empire. It's difficult, more than difficult even, to worship God and to be hopeful in the promise of Jesus Christ when the world around you is dominated by power and money and privilege and earthly desire. These people that John is writing to are being persecuted. They're being oppressed. They're being forced to worship Roman rulers, earthly rulers. And they're turning away from the faith in droves. They're lost. The song that they've been singing, or the song that they've heard through the beginning of their faith as Christians, isn't able to be heard. And they're in need of a new song. So here they get this vision of John, who traveled up into heaven and saw the visions of what was happening in the holy realm of God. And here in chapter 5, following the vision of worship and the reminders of the who created us and all things in this earth, the worship here continues with a vision of this scroll that can't be opened. And John, he begins to weep in the presence of this scroll because he's so sad that nobody can open it. Who's going to open it and read what's in it? Because there's got to be something important written in this heavenly scroll, right? But one of the 24 elders that's there around the throne tells John not to weep because the Lion of the tribe of Judah, he'll come and he'll be able to read it because he's the one who's conquered. It's going to be okay because this powerful lion is going to come and save the day. But right after the elder says that, John looks and sees between the throne and all those who are gathered around the throne, the elders and the living creatures, he sees not a lion, but what? A lamb. A lamb who looks as if it's been slaughtered. And the lamb is the one who is able to take the scroll and open it. And all who are gathered around the one seated on the throne and the lamb there with him, they begin to sing a new song. A song that ascribes power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and blessing not to the lion but to the slaughtered lamb. Not to the lion who is the stronger and more powerful one on earth, but to the lamb who reverses it all. A new song. Or the same song, but with new ears. A reminder of the hope found only in God in Jesus Christ. This new song for the people of John's churches was one that placed power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and blessing on a symbol of weakness, made weaker in its slaughter. By the hands of earthly power, might we be reminded. The multitudes that worship around this throne, in this heavenly place where John is seeing these strange but fantastic holy visions, are singing a new song of a God who ransomed saints from every tribe and language and people and nation through the blood of not a lion, but a lamb. Who rules not by strength, but by the power of weakness found in love and grace. And this new song that John reveals to the people of these churches is not some far-off reality that awaits us, not some end times future, some glory that we'll have someday, but until then we suffer here on earth. No, it is a song for us now, for right now. A hope within the darkness and despair of this world. A hope within the hopelessness of this world. A hope for which the power of the one and only God Almighty is with the weak and the oppressed through the weakness and oppression of the Lamb that he sent to redeem the world. This is a new song for us right here and now. A song that needed to be heard. A song that without John and without the death of Jesus Christ and without a God who so loved the world, a song that would not have been heard. But it is a song that so desperately needs to be heard. Our world needs a new song. Our world needs this new song. When others' actions and the unfairness of this world break you down and grip you in the oppressive power of darkness, you need this new song. When millions and millions of people are without clean water or the necessary food sources because wealth is concentrated with a fraction of a percent of people in this world and the countries in which they live, we need this new song. When leaders of countries have bombs pointed at each other to show their strength and their power, to show they won't be defeated, we need this kind of new song. And when white nationalism marches on a college campus and racial tensions boil over to the point of horrific and unacceptable death and injury, because our country has yet to reconcile with its ugly past, we need this new song. We need a song that places power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing not on those who seize it because of their strength over and against and on top of one another, but with the one who has given his life so that all those things may be known through the weakness of love and grace. Weakness that we know is not weak at all. And so we need to hear this new song and we need to join the chorus. As Christian brothers and sisters, as members of the body of Christ, as human beings created in the image of God, this must be our song. And we must join in singing for the sake of the world, for the sake of those who know darkness in the power of this world and its effects. This song needs to be our song. Worthy is the Lamb who was slaughtered so that people of all tribes and languages and groups and nations might have the power of God within them. The hope that one day they would know something different. That God would put an end to the oppression of earthly rule and give reign to those whom God loves. Worthy is the Lamb, not anyone of this world, who holds true power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. Worthy is the Lamb to be praised and worshipped, the one in whom we should always put our trust, the only one in whom we should put our trust. The one who gives us hope. The one who gives us new hymns to sing. New amens to proclaim. New hallelujah to direct to our Lord. The one who gives us now and always a new song to sing. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we come before you today in need of a new song. Whether we know it or not, whether we believe it or not, oh God, we need a new song in our lives. One that turns to you and expects the wonderful power and might and blessing that you give to all your people. We thank you for sending the Lamb who was slain. The one who came here to earth to recognize within us the darkness and the despair of this world and to take it on himself. So that in his death and resurrection, we might receive new life. And that so our song may be his song, your song, to sing loud in this earth. Worthy are you, O God, to be praised and worshipped. Worthy are you to receive all of our praise. Help us in all that we do to direct our praise to you and to look to you for power and might rather than the things of this earth. And help us in all corners of this world to bring life and peace where it's needed. We pray this all in your Son's name, the Lamb who came to save us, Jesus Christ our Lord.